Thank you for the welcome. So very good morning to everybody present. I hope I am audible. So myself, Ashwati, as I've already been introduced, I am a research scholar at IIT Palakkad. So I work in the area of cold form steel structures with Dr. Anil Kumar MB. And we have been using Abaqis for our simulation works for the past 2 to 3 years, and it has worked very well for us. So I'm just here to share my experience in the area. So in this talk, I would like you to understand the basics of Abaqis. I want you to understand how it works. So I'm going to explain the modeling with a very simple example, that is a steel plate. So I will be explaining it stepwise. I want you to understand each and every step of the analysis so that I want you to understand how it works and and what to keep in mind when you approach your problem. So I'm just going to share my screen. I hope you can see this. So yeah, welcome to the session. So I'm going to talk about modeling of steel structures using Abaqis. So the objective here is to give you an overall idea about Abaqis. And again, we will be specifically talking about steel structures today. So before I begin, what is Abaqis? Abaqis is basically a finite element based on the finite element method. And it is used to solve problems ranging from simple linear analysis to the most challenging nonlinear analysis. So it is a very general purpose simulation tool, and it has a wide range of applications. So here I'm basically interested in a structural problem where I'm looking at stresses and displacements. So this is not just the area where Abaqis is used. It is used in heat transfer problems, soil mechanics, electromagnetics, fluid dynamics, and the list goes on. So Abaqis has a very wide area of application. So the main advantage of using Abaqis is that we can model any geometry. There are large tools available in Abaqis which helps us model if you want a straight, curved, or any complex geometry can be modeled. And also the materials, not only steel and concrete, we can model geotechnical materials like soil and rock. So yeah, very complex analysis can also be done using this software, and that is why presently it is very widely used nowadays. So before I go into the details of Abaqis and its modeling procedure, you have to have at least a small idea about what this finite element analysis is. So FEA involves simulation of any given physical phenomena using the numerical technique called finite element method. So it is just a technique for the computers to solve partial differential equations. So what we are doing is we are representing our physical problem using PDEs, that is partial differential equations, and FEA is used to solve it. Then we can get out relevant quantities like stresses, strains, displacement, anything you want. All those information can be extracted out of it. So the thing you have to remember it is that FEA gives an approximate solution to the problem, and it is a numerical approach to get the real result. So here in FEA, the entire structure, as the name suggests, the entire structure is divided into finite elements. So this image is a finite element model of a steel plate. So we'll be discussing it further. So I just want you to get an idea of what a finite element is. So this is what a typical finite element model would look like. So as you can see here, I've just highlighted the nodes. So the entire structure is divided into small elements, and the calculations are done over each element. And combining the results over each of these elements, we will get the final result of our structure. We will get the result that we need. So this assembly of these nodes and elements together comprise the mesh. So this is the basics of the finite element analysis method. So you're dividing your entire structure into finite elements, and then you're doing your computation over these small elements. So depending upon your structure, there can be like so many thousands and thousands of elements and nodes. So this is a very simple structure that is just a rectangular plate. So any finite element analysis consists of three separate stages. The first one is a post-processing or the modeling stage. So here you create your model graphically, or you can, you know, input it also in Abaqus. So here we are drawing it. We are like drawing the proper geometry of our model, you know, defining the property, the boundary conditions, loads, and all that. You are basically creating your model. So that is the pre-processing or the modeling stage where you create your model. So in Abaqus, this pre-processing, once you create your model, Abaqus generates a file with the extension INP, that is the input file. So this input file basically contains the information of your entire model, that is your nodes, your elements, material, boundary condition, or anything that you've modeled in Abaqus. All that information can be found in the input file. And there are also other uses of this input file, which I will be discussing later on. So that is the first step where you generate the model. The second stage is the processing or the finite element analysis. So here, this is a background process where your computer does the analysis process. That is, it solves the problem defined in the model. So basically, once this processing is done, the output file is generated. And the third stage is the visualization or the post-processing stage, where we see the results. We can graphically view the results. That is, there are options to do animations. You can see the contour plots. You can see images. There are a lot of options available in the post-processing stage in analysis. So this is just how Abaqus works. First, you define the model. Then the simulation, that is the finite element analysis, is performed. And in the third stage, you see the output of your analysis. Okay, so this is what an Abaqus window looks like. So you can see here, you have the menu bar and the toolbar with all your tools, you know, typically used tools are all available here. And this is your viewport where you draw your model. You do all your modeling here. You can see your model here. This is the viewport. And all the tools that are required for you will be available on the side. Okay. So basically, Abaqus is divided into some function units, and they are called modules. So as you can see here in the drop-down menu, that is basically here. I've just highlighted this. So these are the different modules in Abaqus. So basically, it is a logical sequence of the modeling process. That is, you know, you first you define, then you assign, then you draw, things like that. You know, it's the stepwise of how you build up on your model. So this is just a logical sequence. It is not necessary that you follow this order. It is very user friendly. You can, you know, do it in any order you like, but this is just the logical order of the modeling process. So you can see there are different modules like part, property, assembly, and it goes on. So I will be explaining each and every module and what it is actually based on a very simple example of a steel plate. Okay. So as you go through the lecture, you will get to know what each module is and how you can apply it. I mean, I want you to get an idea of how to approach the problem you have in hand. Okay, so that is why I've gone for a very simple example of a steel plate, so that anybody who attends this lecture will be able to follow it. Okay, so another thing is this part of this Abaqus window on the left side, this is called the model tree. So this gives you all the tools that are available here. It is just another representation, you know, it's written. So it's more user friendly over there. You can just choose your tools from here also. It's the same thing. It's just written. So it'll be sometimes it's just easier to do it this way. So whichever you find easy, you can just follow that. And another thing is, if you don't know what any tool is, just keep your cursor on it for 2 seconds and it will be written on the side what each tool is. So this is actually a very user-friendly software, and you will find a lot of tutorials, and you will find the Abaqus manual itself, which gives you very good details about the software. So yeah, as I told, I will be explaining the modeling of steel structures. Very simple example, that is a steel plate which is subjected to uniform compression. So here I have gone with a plate that is simply supported on three sides. So this is basically a rectangular plate of dimensions that is width B and length L. So it is subjected to uniform compression. It is simply supported on three sides and it is free along one of the longitudinal edge. So this is the plate, the modeling of this plate, which I will be using to explain you about the modeling techniques. So yeah, the first step is the part module. So in the part module, you create individual parts by sketching their geometry. So parts basically define the geometry of individual components of the model. And you know, they are like the building blocks of your abacus model. So in this particular problem, I have only a single part, that is my rectangular steel plate. So, but in more complex models, there can be multiple parts. So you have to specifically draw each part. So here I've not renamed, you can just rename it here. Okay, here in the part module, you can rename it. I have not gone for it. By default, it will be named as part one, part two, part three, etc. So depending upon the complexity of your model, there can be multiple parts in your model. So you have to draw each part separately, right? So for this particular model, I have a rectangular plate. So, and again, you have to understand your problem and then go with the specific options available. For example, here I'm drawing a rectangular plate. So the dimensions are the width, length, and thickness, that is B, L, and the thickness T. So the thickness of the plate is much smaller in comparison to my width and length. So for this case, I will be going with a shell element. So shell elements basically are used to model structures in which one dimension is very small compared to the other two dimensions. So that is what you have to understand the problem that you are trying to model. Only then you will be able to approach it and, you know, go with the specific options available. So suppose I'm going with another section in which the cross section is very small as compared to the length. So then I can just go with this option called wire, where it will just look like a line. So there I have to specify my cross section in the later stages. So that is what you have to understand your problem very well. Only then you will be able to apply it properly or model it properly in abacus. So here, as I told, I'm going with a shell element. So since mine is a 2D structure, I'm going with a planar option here. So this is what my window would look like once I've gone with this option. So you will have grid lines which will assist you in drawing. So this is just like any normal tool where you can draw your geometry. So there are, as you can see in the site, there are a lot of options available. You can draw circles, you can draw rectangles, you can draw curves, or you can just draw nodes and, you know, just connect them. And there are a lot of tools available for you to help you draw the geometry. So for this case, I'm just going to go with the rectangular tool. So as you can see, I've just highlighted this. I'm just drawing a rectangle. So as I told, there are multiple ways in which you can do this. So you can either just draw a rectangle and then there is this dimensioning tool that is available here with which you can just adjust the dimensions of your rectangle. Or can you see the at the bottom of the screen, pick a starting corner for the rectangle or enter XY. So another way to draw is to enter the coordinates. So if you know the coordinates of your plate, you can just directly input the coordinates, and that is also one way of doing it. So this part of the window at the bottom where you have messages like this written, that is called the prompt window. So whenever you model, just make sure you keep an eye out for the prompt window. You know, a lot of messages will be displayed in the prompt window. You might be asked to, you know, agree to certain changes to your model, or you might lose the changes if you do not agree in the prompt window. And you know, if you're trying to do something, the steps, what you have to do, how you have to do, all that, you will have messages related to what you're doing and in the prompt window. So always keep an eye out for the prompt window at the bottom of your screen. So here I've just drawn the rectangle using the rectangle tool, and this is what my plate model will look like. So this is just this is a very simple model of a rectangle plate. So as I told, depending upon the complexity, I will have multiple parts. So here for this model, I have only part one, that is my rectangular plate. If I have more complex models, there can be part one, part two, etc. and each of those, you can choose it and view it individually. So here I have only a single part. So the next module is the property module. So in the property module, you can create a section and, material definitions, and you have to assign it. So you can see here, this is just, I just wanted to show you the material manager, what the dialog box would look like. So there are different options. As I told, Abacus has a wide range of methods in which you can model your material. So basically in this module, I'm trying to define my material and define the section for, as I told you, for this particular case, I'm modeling the shell. So here my length and breadth have already been modeled, but my thickness is not specified. For this particular case, my thickness will be an input here. Suppose I'm drawing, as I told you, if I'm modeling a wire element. So in that case, I will have to specify the cross section. That is whether it is rectangular, hollow, circle, or any arbitrary shape. There are a lot of options available in Abacus to do that. So all that where you define your section, you define the properties of your section. That is what this module does. So here in the steel here is modeled as an elastic plastic model. So as you can see here, I will go for the option elastic, and then I will go with the option plastic. So this is the most widely used material model for steel, where you input the elastic and the plastic parameters. So I will be discussing about the elastic and plastic parameters in a little while. Okay, so this is how you define your materials. And as I told, the shell elements which I've used here, the length and width have been specified. So now I need to specify my thickness. So here I will specify my thickness value and I will just agree to this. So now the next step is I have defined my section, I've defined my material. Third step is to assign it. So there is this section assignment manager again in this property module, which is used to assign these properties to your section. So as you can see, here this red color is basically, Abacus has these color schemes which help you identify whether a particular section is being chosen or not. Look at this. Initially, it was this gray color plate. So when I'm trying to assign the section and I'm choosing it, it is highlighted in some kind of red shade. So there are a lot of color schemes in Abacus, present in Abacus, which will guide you through these steps. Okay. So here I just have one cross section, that is my shell element with the thickness of 2 mm that I've just inputted and the material of steel, which I've just given. So I can choose the section and the material in this dialog box. So here again, you have to know that there can be multiple materials, there can be multiple cross sections in your model. So you have to choose, highlight or, choose what area you want to assign. And then based on the options that you have modeled, you can choose from the sections. Okay, so there are, you can have multiple cross sections, multiple materials all in a single model. You just have to be very careful when you assign it. Make sure that you don't go wrong when you assign your section. And there are also options to edit it. So even if you go wrong, you can just delete or edit your option. So this is what I told about the color scheme. So this is the plate it looks like after the section has been assigned. So in the section assignment manager, you will be able to view all the sections. So in this case, I just have one section, that is a shell with this material and this the set I have assigned it to. So as I told, you can rename it to any thing you want. This is just by default. I just maintained it like this so that you can understand it properly. So as I told, you can have multiple sections like section 1, 2, 3, 4, etc., depending upon your model. So you can view all that in this section assignment manager. So again, as I told, you can delete or edit this section assignment if you make a mistake. And make sure that you have assigned it properly, because definitely you will get error in your results if you go wrong here. So make sure that you have done this step properly. So this is about the property module. So next is the assembly module. So in the assembly module, when we create, that is when we create a part initially, you remember, no, where we use the rectangular tools or any tool that are available to draw the geometry and all, we are drawing it in its own coordinate system. That is, we are drawing it in some of its local coordinate system, right? It is independent of the other parts. So we are individually drawing the different parts of our model. So in the assembly module, what we are doing is we are creating instances of these different parts and we are positioning these instances relative to each other in a global coordinate system. That is, suppose I'm modeling some column with the end plates. So one part would be my column and the second part would be my end plates. So I will be modeling it separately. That is, part one would be my column and part two would be my end plates. So these two are two independent parts. I want to assemble it, that and hence the name assembly for this module. I need to assemble it and make it act as a single model. For this, I make use of this assembly module. So in that case, there are options here. You can see there are options to copy, you know, position, rotate, you know, change the position. And there are different options available to edit and delete your instances and, you know, make the model, final model that you want. So for this example that I'm talking about, I just have a simple rectangular plate and I don't have multiple parts here. So here this is the only part that is available for me. So if I'm having the parts, all the parts that you've modeled initially will appear here, part one, part two, part three, all that will appear if you have multiple parts. So the next module is basically the step module. So in the step module, you can create and configure the analysis steps and the output requests. So in this particular problem, I have gone for two kinds of analysis. One is the linear elastic analysis, that is, or the eigenvalue buckling analysis. And second is the nonlinear analysis. So with this nonlinear analysis, you will get the actual strength of the plate. So my aim basically was to find out what is the strength of that plate under axial compression. This plate that is simply supported on three sides and free along one edge, which is subjected to uniform compression. My aim was to find out the strength of that plate. So doing a nonlinear analysis, I will be going on to the details of this in the later stage, but doing a nonlinear analysis, I will get the actual strength of the plate. So, but for these compression members, buckling is a very important phenomenon. So I hope you have an idea of buckling. That is, when subjected to axial compression, if the member undergoes sudden lateral deformation, it is said to undergo buckling. So it is very important to study buckling because it can compromise the load bearing capacity of your members. That is, it can cause a member to fail even before the material capacity is reached. So it is very important to understand buckling and its effects on your structure, especially when you're dealing with compression members. So in this, basically, I'm dealing with compression members and the example I'm talking about is also under axial compression. That is a plate that is under axial compression. And so buckling is a very important part of our work. So basically, I'm working on buckling modes and interactions. So as such, buckling analysis is very important for my work. So, but another thing you have to remember is this buckling does not always mean that your structure fails. You know, there are cases where your member can handle more load after buckling. So that is called the post-buckling strength. So to understand all that, first you have to do a linear eigenvalue buckling analysis. And then another thing is that you will be using the results of your eigenvalue analysis to do the nonlinear analysis also. So I will be discussing that also. So this is just an example of the result of the eigenvalue buckling analysis. So from the buckling analysis, basically you get two main results. One is the buckling load. That is the load at which the plate buckles. That is, you're applying a uniform compression to the plate. So initially it will undergo axial compression only. And at a particular load, it will undergo this lateral out of plane deformations. So this is just another view. This is the same plate. I've just tilted it and I'm just presented it in another view so that you can understand it better. So as you can see, this plate, it is free over this edge and simply supported on these three edges. This is the result from my eigenvalue buckling analysis. So here it has buckled in a single half wave. So this, as you can see, just follow my cursor here. So this is the buckled shape of my plate. So it has buckled in a single half wave and across along its length. So this is the buckled mode shape. This is called a buckled mode shape. So another important result from my eigenvalue analysis is my buckling load. That is the load at which this buckling has occurred. So as you can see, this is the result of my analysis from Abacus. I've just printed the screen. So as you can see, I've just highlighted it at the bottom. The eigenvalue, or this is basically your buckling load, that is 4935. So another thing that you have to keep in mind while doing your modeling is that Abacus is not confined to any specific unit. You can follow any system of unit that you like. So here I have gone with a Newton and mm units. So, but make sure you follow it consistently, because you might make results, or you might get wrong results if you go wrong in your units. So here I've gone with Newton and mm. So basically my result here is in Newton. So 4935 Newton is the buckling load of my plate. So depending upon your structure, as I told, it can fail by buckling, or it can even handle load after buckling. So you need to understand this buckling load. You need to have an idea of the buckling load and all to understand whether it has this post buckling capacity or not. So as I told, I'm working in the area of buckling and buckling mode interactions. So all this is very important in my analysis work. And so another advantage of the use of this buckling analysis is that I will be making use of these mode shapes. As I told, this is called a mode shape. That is the shape in which your structure buckles. So that is called a mode shape. So what I am doing is, like in actual practice, these plates are not perfectly flat. That is because of the very small thickness and all, it can have these out of plane deformations, or some kind of imperfection will be present in these plates actually. So to model those imperfections, to model my imperfect geometry, I can make use of these buckled mode shapes. That is just one way, okay? I'm just saying this is one method we use commonly to model the imperfect geometry. So here we make use of the results of our eigenvalue buckling analysis, and that is used as an input parameter in the nonlinear analysis to model your imperfect geometry. Okay. So now, as I told you, these are the parameters for steel, where we are modeling it as an elastic plastic material model that's commonly used for steel. So in the elastic material model, you can see you have the elastic parameters, that is Young's modulus, Poisson's ratio, as your input parameters. So as you know, steel is a ductile material, and the characteristic of this is the plastic region. So the very important characteristic of this ductile material is the yield strength, the ultimate stress, and the strains, plastic strains basically. So here you have to input, this is basically my yield stress and my ultimate stress along with the plastic strains. So commonly in Abacus, you model the true stress strain behavior, because we are trying to model the actual structure. So, you know, depending upon how good you model the actual geometry, or how good you are able to model the material, your analysis results, you know, it will depend on all that. So I am trying to simulate the actual material properties. So that is why commonly we go with the true stress strain properties of steel. So based on the Coupon test results, I will import my Young's modulus values and the yield stress, ultimate stress, and the plastic strain parameters. So this is how the elastic plastic material model for steel will be modeled. So now comes the non-linear analysis. So as I told, once you do a non-linear analysis, accounting for all the non-linearities present in your actual structures, you will be able to get the strength of this structure. That is, just imagine, you will be able to predict the strength of the structure without even doing experiments. So that is where all this Abacus and the simulation and all comes into picture. So here, because we cannot, perform, in the work I do, we are looking at these design equations and all. So we require to do a large parametric study. For example, we are changing the dimensions, the material properties, boundary conditions, all that. We vary and we do large parametric studies. So in actual practice, we cannot just, perform experiments and for such cases. So for these cases, what we do is we run these simulations using Abacus. So nowadays, Abacus is very, very widely being used. So it is a very good simulation tool. And as I told, it has worked very well for our analysis. And we have been using it for the past 2 to 3 years, and we still continue to use it, right? So now talking about the nonlinear analysis, here in the SEC module, we can choose whether we want to account for the nonlinear effects which come from large displacements and deformations. That is, if your displacements are small, the effects of these deformations or the displacements can be safely ignored. But in cases where the loads result in large displacements, these non-linear geometric effects become important. So in my case, for the buckling analysis, I'm going with the linear analysis where I'm just going for the elastic linear analysis where I am not concerned about the non-linearities. For the non-linear analysis, which is the actual analysis where I'm looking for the actual strength of the plate, I want to account for all the non-linearities. So depending upon your problem, if you go for a linear analysis, sometimes if these displacements are small and can be ignored, the results of your linear and your non-linear analysis might be same. But again, that is specific to your problem. Depends upon your problem. So for my case, here for step two, that is where I'm going for the nonlinear analysis, I have switched on. So in Abacus, you have an option to switch on or off. So this this is the option. This is called NLGO, so nonlinear geometric effects. So this is an option which accounts for this nonlinear effects in Abacus. So you can switch it off or on depending upon your problem. So basically, you have to understand that once you switch it on, it is like an incremental analysis. That is, the displacement or the load that you're applied will be applied in increments. Suppose you're applying a 100 kilonewton, you're applying to your structure. Just for the sake of an example, I'm just giving you some values. And you can specify the increments in Abacus. Suppose I'm going with an increment size of 1 kilonewton. That means Abacus will apply, 1 kilonewton at a time, and you can specify the range, the maximum and the minimum and all that. You can specify all that in your step manager. And Abacus performs an incremental analysis to give you the nonlinear results. So this, as I told, NLGO is the option in Abacus, which can be used here. This is the step manager. So you can see that, right? In the step manager, you can go and switch off or on your NLGO option. So here in the first stage for the elastic linear buckling analysis, I want a linear analysis. I'm not looking for the non-linear option. So I switch it off. And for the second non-linear analysis, where I've gone for a static general analysis, I switch it on because I want to account for these non-linear geometric effects. So once you switch it on, what happens is the analysis is based on your deformed configuration. That is, at each increment, the deformed configuration of your particular increment will be applied to your next increment, and it goes on. So depending upon the complexity of your structure, this nonlinear analysis can take time. So for this case, what I've done is I've gone with a displacement controlled analysis. So you can go for a load control or a displacement control or any analysis that you're looking for. There are wide options available in Abacus. So for this particular problem, I have gone with a nonlinear analysis with displacement control. So as you can see here, I've applied a displacement of -2 mm across one of the edges. So again, you can also go, as I told you, you can go with the load control analysis or a displacement control analysis depending upon your problem. For this problem, I have chosen a displacement control analysis. And you can, you know, just specify this value. We can increase it, decrease it. All that is, again, specific to your problem. So for this nonlinear analysis, I basically accounted for two types of nonlinearities. That is, one is a material nonlinearity and second is a geometric nonlinearity. So material nonlinearity is what we just discussed. That is, if you remember the stress strain graph of steel, the initial part where you have the linear elastic part, it is just a straight line, right? So that is basically the elastic material model. And beyond yielding and all that, you remember that the graph becomes non-linear. So to account for all that, we go for this non-linear elastic, for the non-linear analysis, we go for this elastic plastic material model. So this is how we account for the material non-linearity in this analysis. So the second kind of non-linearity that I'm interested in is the geometric nonlinearity. So geometric nonlinearity basically means here, as I told you, in actual practice, these sections or these members can have imperfections. It need not be perfectly flat. And experimentally, if you go through any journals, you will see that experimentally it will be measured. So you can make use of those values if it is available to you. If those values are available to you, you can make use of those values and model your imperfect geometry. Or there are other methods of modeling imperfection, which I will be discussing in some time. Okay, so I'll just repeat. We are basically going with two kinds of analysis. One is the linear analysis or the eigenvalue buckling analysis, which gives me the buckling loads and the buckled mode shapes. And the second kind of analysis is the nonlinear analysis, where I'm switching on the NL geom option to account for the nonlinear geometric effects. So here I've gone with the displacement control analysis, where I'm applying a uniform displacement from one of the edges in the axial direction. And as I told you, here we are accounting for two kinds of nonlinearities. One is a material nonlinearity and the second is the geometric nonlinearity. Material nonlinearity is this part where you model the material as your model the material as elastic plastic. And geometric nonlinearity is where you where you model your imperfect geometry. That is, your plate is not need not be perfectly flat. It can have undulations. So you are modeling that using Abacus. So to account for those imperfections, we go with the imperfect geometry. So the next module is the load module. So in the load module, you specify the loads, the boundary conditions, the predefined fields, and all that. You know, there are very large number of options available in Abacus to specify all this. As you can see, even in the load manager, there are concentrated force, edge loads, line load, gravity loads, a lot of options are available for you. So this is just an example of the uniform compression that I've applied to my plate across one of the edges. Another thing you have to specify is the boundary condition. So this boundary condition is based on the coordinate system that is specified here. That is the X, Y, and Z direction that is specified at the bottom of your model. So this, we have U1, U2, U3, UR1, UR2, and UR3 as my 6th degree of freedom. That is basically based on X, Y, and Z axis. So U1 is basically the translation along X, U2 translation along Y, and U3 the translation along Z axis. And UR1, UR2, UR3 are the rotations about X, Y, and Z axis. So this is based on the coordinate system that is specified here. So suppose you want to, model a boundary condition, or you want to apply a load in some other direction, because here it is in this particular coordinate system is what by default, this is what is available to you. Suppose I want to apply some, an inclined constraint at maybe some 30 degree, I want to apply a constraint here. So you can see these options. These are the options available in Abacus where you can specify your coordinate system. You can choose the coordinate system. You can, define any other coordinate system according to your interest, according to the problem that you have at hand. You can do that, and then you can, instead of applying your boundary conditions or the loads with respect to your global coordinate system, you can just go with the coordinate system that you just specified. Okay, so this is about the load and the boundary condition. And as I told you, you can just edit, delete, or create new boundary conditions and loads in this step. And another thing you have to remember is that these loads are specified or step dependent. That is, if you want to apply a load in a particular step, you have to specify it like that. So according to your problem, there can be multiple steps, step one, step two, step three. So depending upon here, this is just the result, how I've applied the load for the eigenvalue analysis. So here I've just a single step, that is my eigenvalue analysis, where I'm applying a uniform compression. So here, depending upon the number of steps you have, you will have multiple options here. So make sure that you apply your load in the correct step according to your problem. So in this problem, I have no such confusion because I have only a single step. But you have to keep that in mind that your loads and your boundary conditions are step dependent. Okay, so that is, I told you, we are going for this displacement control analysis. So this is specific to this static general step, that is the nonlinear analysis step. So I have to go and edit my boundary condition in that particular step, or I have to go and apply my load in that particular step. So depending upon your problem, you have to keep that in mind that you have to specify your loads and your boundary conditions depending upon the step that is required. Just make sure you keep that in mind. So this is about the load and the boundary conditions. So the next is the meshing. This is the basics of the finite element analysis. This is what we started with, right? So you are you have to divide your entire structure into small finite elements. So there are multiple ways to do that, right? So here you can either go with the element size. This is the mesh module. You will see options that are specific to your meshing. You can create, delete, edit. There are a lot of options available on the site for all that specific to the meshing part of your meshing part. Okay, so you can mesh your structure either based on the size of the element. Here I've gone with an element size of 5 mm, right? So that again depends upon your problem. You have to specify either the size or the number of elements. There are options to do this. It's called local sieves. And here you can specify the number of elements. Suppose I want around 15 elements across this edge. So what do? I choose this edge and I go with this option and I go with the number 15 and click OK. So you can see that this edge will be divided into 15 elements. So whether you go with this kind of meshing or this kind of meshing, it does not make a difference. At the end, your result will be the same, but depending upon your problem, there are problems in which where the number of elements is important. That is, if you want to join different parts of a geometry, one way to do it is by through the mesh. That is, through the nodes, you can connect different parts. So for connecting different parts through the nodes, you have to ensure that the meshing in the corresponding area where you're joining it is equal. So for such cases, it might be necessary that you mesh your model using this number of elements. So this again, as I told, it's specific to your problems. It is not necessary. Then again, keep in mind the prompt window. It will be asking you messages like this. Okay to mesh the part. Only if you agree to this will your part be meshed. So you have to always watch out for the messages in your prompt window. So as I told, there are color schemes in abacus. This is what a meshed model will look like. So I've gone with an element of size 5 mm. So you can see these small rectangular or square elements. I've gone with elements of size 5 mm. So that again, how do you know what is the size of the element you choose or how many number of elements you require? So for one of the methods to do that is to do a mesh convergence study. That is, as the more elements you have or the more degree of meshing you do, your results will be better. But the problem there is, if you go with very, very small meshing, it will take a lot of time for your analysis to happen. It will take a lot of time. How much time your computer takes depends upon all this, upon the number of elements and the number of nodes and all that. So this is a very simple structure where I have only a small rectangular plate. So just imagine you have a very, very long structure, like a 3 meter long section. So I'm modeling it. Just imagine the number of elements I would have if I go with the 5 mm element, right? So depending upon the problem, it is very important that you choose your mesh correctly. So for that, you do a mesh convergence study. That is, if you increase the number of elements beyond a particular value, it is not going to affect your results. So it is not advantageous to go for a very small mesh because it will take a lot of time. So what you do is, in a mesh convergence study, you do your analysis with different number of elements. That is, you start with very small elements, maybe 5 elements, then you go with 7, 10, like that. You keep increasing your elements, or you can just play with the element size, whichever is comfortable with you. You do that and you can see that the results will converge beyond a particular value. For my analysis, what I found was that beyond the 5 mm mesh, if I go for a smaller size of my mesh, there it does not affect my results. The only thing that will happen is it will take more time. So why would I go with such a mesh, right? So this is a very important step when you are doing this. Meshing is very important because this is the basics of the finite element analysis that we just discussed, right? You have to be very careful in the meshes. And here again, this is a square element. There are different kinds of elements that are available. Abacus has a wide variety of elements that you can apply to your model. So here again, as I told you, we are going with a shell element. So again, specific to your problem, you have to choose the mesh and the elements. So one thing you can do is you can study the standard literatures that are available to you. There are a lot of papers present nowadays based on these numerical techniques and analysis, where they have done a large in-depth study of the type of elements, type of the number of elements and kind of analysis, all that. So specific to your area, you have to make sure that you undergo a very thorough literature survey. So then you will have an overall idea of how to model, what is the mesh you have, what is the kind of element you have to use, all that. There are a large number of numerical papers available nowadays, especially in Abacus. There are a lot of researchers working, using Abacus. So definitely you will find papers on numerical analysis. So make sure you have a thorough understanding of all that before you directly start your modeling. So make sure that your meshing is correct. So as I told you, if you are combining different parts, suppose I'm trying to combine another part using this edge. So what I have to ensure is that the number of nodes I have here, that is the number of elements across this edge, should match with that, the other part also. So for all that, your meshing should be correct. So if you go wrong in your meshing, this might not look very complex here because I'm having a simple model with a plate. I didn't want to complicate my talk here, so I've just gone with a simple structure like this. For complex structures, like suppose you're modeling a plate with a hole, if you've done that, you will definitely come to know that you have to be very careful while you're meshing. This is a very important step in your modeling part. So the next, the final one is the job module. So here you are, this job module is used to analyze your model. So now the modeling part or the pre-processing part is done, where you have created the geometry, the material, the sections, you have assembled it, you have meshed it, all that, you're assigned your loads, boundary condition, all that is done. Your model is ready. So now the next step is to analyze your model, right? So this job module is used to analyze your model, okay? So here we can submit a job. We can, as you can see, there are two options while you create a job. Either you can create a job using the model, or you can create it using the input file. So if you remember what an input file is, in the initial portion of this lecture, we were talking about the pre-processing stage, where we talked about the entire modeling process. So once the modeling process is done, Abacus will generate a file, and that is called the input file with the extension .inp. So how do you generate an input file? You create a job, and there is an option called write input in Abacus. So this will create a file with the extension .inp, which contains the details of all your, the entire details of your model, that is the nodes, elements, boundary conditions, everything, each and everything that you just did, all the modules that we had just gone through, right? So every step that you have done, all the details of that will be present in this .inp file. So you can either run the analysis directly using the model, or as you can see here, what I've done is I've input run the analysis using the .inp file. So you can create a job either directly by analyzing your model or by analyzing your input file. The advantage of this step, where you can analyze it using your input file, is you can make changes to your model in the input file. So input file, you can just open it using your text editor, and you can, I'll just show it to you. So you can make your changes in the input file. So that is a very, good part of it, where you can edit it. You don't have to go through the model, entire model. If you just want to change some parameter, you don't have to, redo your model and again, you can just go and edit that specific part in your input file. And you can just run that analysis. So, and here you can see that you can monitor the analysis as it goes. That is, you can see how the analysis is progressing. And you can submit, submit is basically where you submit the job for analysis. You can submit multiple jobs at a time. You can view the, monitor the progress of multiple jobs at the time. And as you can see here, once you click the results option, you will be able to visualize the results of that particular job. So as I told, this is an example of an .inp file. So here, as you can see, I've just named this job as L, and I've just given the option write input. So this file will be generated with the extension .inp, L.inp. So depending upon the name that you give, your .inp file will have a that name, and by default the name is job 1, job 2, job 3, etc. So depending, all this is just, you know, for how you find it easy, what name you want to give, you can just give it there. So this is what a typical .inp file looks like. This is the .inp file of one plate, that rectangular plate which I was talking about. So as you can see, it contains the details about the entire modeling that we just did. So here you can see the job name, that is this one L, and the model name, I've not changed it. So it is model one. Whatever changes that you make over there in the modeling process, all that will be reflected here in your .inp file. So this is a very, wonderful thing, where you can view all your analysis, view all your modeling parts. So as I told, you can see, look at this, this is your material, this is your boundary condition, and everything, each and every step of your modeling can be viewed in this file. So I'll just repeat, this is the input file with the extension .inp, which contains the details of your entire model. So as I told you, the whole basics of this Abacus is the finite element analysis, where your entire model is divided into elements and nodes, right? I hope you remember that, where you're dividing your entire model into small elements, that is the finite elements, and those junctures or those points are called nodes. So in the input file, you can get the information of all this. So I just highlighted one such thing just to tell you what it is. So node number one has the coordinates minus 50, 0, 0. Node number two has the coordinates minus 44, 0, 0, etc. So since we are going for a 2D structure, I mean, in the plate that I just modeled, it is a 2D structure. So I just have the XY coordinates of all my nodes. My Z coordinates is 0. So just look at this. I have 3024 nodes in my structure. This is the model of a simple plate, a rectangular plate. There is no complexity in this model, right? You just have a rectangular plate and the number of nodes is 3024. So just imagine what the number of nodes would be when you are modeling a very complex geometry. So that is the power. This is where you can actually see the power of Abacus. It doesn't matter if you have 1,000 nodes or 10,000 nodes, all that information will be present exactly like this, where you have the details of each of these nodes in your INP file. And you can also see the elements, that is element one. So in my work, we have gone with the rectangular element. We have 1, 2, 3, 4 nodes at the four corners of my rectangular element. So this gives me the connectivity, or it gives me the details of each of the element. That is, element one is connected by nodes 1, 2, 20, and 19. So similarly, I will get the details of every element. So similar to this, I have a large number of elements also. So again, depending upon your problem, there can be a huge, huge number of elements and nodes present in your work. So depending upon, you know, as these elements and nodes, the number of all this increases, definitely your analysis will take more time. So this particular case, my analysis where I'm looking at these rectangular plate, the analysis does not take much time. You will get it in a matter of minutes, 5 to 10 minutes, your analysis will be done. But there are jobs where it will take hours and hours for your analysis to finish off, because it depends upon the, all this depends upon the complexity of your model and the meshing and all that. So as the number of nodes and the number of elements increases, it will definitely take more time for your analysis to happen. So as we discussed, we had modeled the material as elastic plastic. So this is basically my Young's models of elasticity and Poisson's ratio. And this is the values of my yield load and my yield stress and my ultimate stress. And these are the plastic strains. So again, as I told, usual practice when we are trying, especially when we are looking at the experimental results, is to model the true stress strain behavior, because I'm trying to model something that actually happens, right? This is not anything imaginary. Actually, we have a steel plate and that is under compression. So I'm trying to model that using, I'm trying to simulate that result using my Abacus. So how well I can model my actual plate, that good my results will be. So here, this will give you the details of the loads, materials, boundary conditions, and everything, right? So do you remember that we had discussed about the nonlinear analysis, where we are looking for the imperfect geometry, right? So here, this I'm just going to discuss one way to model the imperfect geometry. One way is, you can, you know, this is the coordinates of your node, right? So if you know how your plate has buckled, if you know the coordinates of each and every plate, you can just generate it as an Excel. You can just, using Excel, you can just generate the coordinates, X, Y, Z coordinates, right? If you know the actual imperfect geometry. So one way to do is, you can just edit it over here. You can just edit the coordinates of your nodes, but make sure that you do it properly, because if the node coordinates, if you go wrong there, your analysis definitely will go wrong. So all this, make sure, you know, when you edit the input file, make sure you do it with a lot of care, because if you go wrong in your input file, your analysis will definitely go wrong. And again, I keep repeating, make sure you follow consistent sets of units when you do your analysis. Throughout your analysis, keep that in mind, okay? So here, as I told, I've gone with Newton and mm. So depending upon the units, you can just follow any unit you want, but make sure that you go with a specific unit. So one method I told was you can just edit your coordinates in this INP file, or there is another method. Do you remember we told that you can just make use of the eigenvalue buckling analysis and make use of the mode shapes to to model your imperfect geometry. So that is exactly what I'm discussing now. So basically we are making use of the mode shapes from the buckling analysis. You remember that where the plate buckled in a single half wave, mode shapes are those shape of in which they buckle. So that is a very common practice where if you don't know the actual imperfection, you can just make use of that mode shape to model your imperfect geometry. So for that, you need the coordinate, you need the shape, right? So basically, this is all related to the coordinates of the nodes, right? So you need the coordinates of the node in that particular buckled configuration. So to get that details of the mode shape, I go with this command. It is called star node print command. So if I add this command in my input file and I run this input file, there will be another file with an extension .fil, fil file, which will have the details of the buckled mode shapes. So this is another method. Okay, there are multiple ways in which a problem can be solved in Abaqus. So I'm just discussing two such methods of introducing imperfection, geometric imperfection to your model. One is by modifying the coordinates directly, and the second is by making use of your buckling mode shapes. So another thing you have to note is that it will be saved in the same name that you have for this particular file with the extension. Instead of l.inp, it will be l.fil, right? So make sure that you shouldn't go wrong with these file names. All that will, your analysis won't run. Basically, you'll have a lot of error messages in Abaqus. So make sure that your naming and all, you don't go wrong in your naming and all that, right? So this is how you generate the FIL file, which will be used to model your imperfect geometry. So as I told, we are running a nonlinear analysis where we are making use of this imperfect geometry. So how do you input this imperfect geometry into your nonlinear analysis? So this l.inp file was for the linear analysis where you went for the eigenvalue buckling analysis. So for the nonlinear analysis, you similarly come up with another input file. Where you remember where I was talking about the displacement control analysis. For that particular one, you again generate an input file. So this is, I'll just put the snipping of only the relevant portion from that nonlinear analysis input file. So this is just a snip out of that input file. So this is the command that I will be using to introduce this geometric imperfection into my model. So this is the star imperfection command, right? So here you have to be very careful in all these things because it is very sensitive to all these cases and all that. So here, make sure that your file, you remember that file I was talking about with the extension .fil, where it contains the details of my mode shapes. So you have to make sure that you give the same name here. You are making use of that file which contains that information to input your imperfect geometry. So make sure you don't go wrong in all these steps. It might sound very trivial now, but once you do the analysis, you will understand that if you go wrong in any of these steps, you will end up with a large number of errors in your analysis. So make sure that you don't mess up all these steps, right? So here, this is basically my mode number and the imperfection factor. So that is, as I told you, we are, before I talk about the mode number, let me talk about the imperfection factors. Experimentally, if this work is being done, as I told you, you can actually measure out the imperfection. Suppose I'm having a plate, how much out of plane deformation is there? What is the amount of imperfection in the plate? You can measure it out experimentally. So one way to do the, you can measure out that imperfection experimentally and input that value, maybe an average value or a maximum value, depending upon your problem. You can make use of that parameter and input that parameter here. So now going on to the mode number. As I, you remember that it buckles, we were talking about the results of the buckling analysis. What I had presented was a first mode. You know, we are usually concerned with the first mode because we are looking at the buckling load and the corresponding mode shape. So usually this is the critical mode, and usually in usual practice, you use the first mode as your imperfection. That as done here, I have gone with the first mode with the imperfection factor 0.18. So as you can see, depending upon your problem, you know, if you use a higher mode or not, like for this specific, this problem, if I make use of modes 2 and 3 also, it is not going to affect my results. So then again, you have to do an imperfection study for your model, because all these imperfections will affect the strength of your structure. And that again is specific to your problems. In the area of research that I'm doing, it is very sensitive to these imperfections, geometric imperfections. So initially what we do is we do an imperfection study where we use different factors, where we use different mode shapes. All that is being used, and a thorough imperfection study was firstly done. So in this specific to this plate, as I told, if you use the higher modes also, it is not going to affect your results much. But there are cases in which the higher modes of buckling will affect your result. So this is just for the sake of example. I'm not going to explain the details of these structures. So this, I just for the sake of understanding, what I'm trying to say is this is the result of the eigenvalue analysis from a lipped, of a lipped channel section. This is called a lipped channel, the C-shaped lipped channel section. So it can buckle in different shapes. So the plate here, it buckles like this with a single half wave with the out of plane deformations. But when you're going to a cross-section level, it can bend out like this. As you can see, there is a translation in the lateral direction. The load is axial and the translation is in the transverse direction. This is one kind of buckling. The other one where there is this out-of-plane deformation, the cross-section as such, it does not move. Here it has translated, but here it is not. There is out-of-plane deformation. And another mode where there is a change in the shape of the cross-section. So I'm not going to the details of it. I'm not trying to complicate my talk here. All I'm trying to do say is, depending upon your problem, these different modes of buckling may or may not affect your results. But you have to make sure that you study and understand it properly. So for such cases where it can buckle in different modes, these different modes have to be input as your imperfection parameters. It can affect your results. Suppose my first mode is this and my fifth mode is this, then I go with the imperfection factor 1, some factor, and in the next line 5, some factor. Okay, so how you choose this factor is also important. Suppose you don't have the experimental results or you are doing a parametric study. What is the parameter that I choose? As I told, there are wide number of numerical papers present nowadays where these value of the imperfection, average value of the imperfection factor is specified, like 0.1 times thickness, 0.34 times thickness, or L by 1000. There are a lot of papers specific. That is what you have to go through a thorough literature survey of your area to understand the imperfection factors and all that. Right. So this is based on making use of these buckled mode shape in the star imperfection command, you do your nonlinear analysis. So this is just the results of my eigenvalue linear analysis and my nonlinear analysis. As I told, from the eigenvalue analysis, you will get the buckled mode shape and the buckling load. So you can see here, no, you can see the mode shapes. That is, you can see the displacements U1, U2, U3, and you can also see the rotations. As I told, this is a normalized plot. Any mode you take, the maximum value will be 1. That is, you are just getting a shape. It does not make, practically, it does not make any sense. I mean, this buckled mode shape, it will be a normalized plot with the maximum value 1. So that is why you can directly use a scaling factor. So that is, if you have a maximum imperfection of 0.5, if you go with an imperfection factor of 0.5 with this model, the entire, all the coordinates will be multiplied with 0.5. So you will have a maximum value of u as 0.5. So that is the logic behind this. Then this is just a result of my nonlinear analysis, where I can view the stresses, strains, anything you want, the reaction forces, the displacements, be it axial or transverse, anything and everything, you know, a large variety of options will be available once you do a nonlinear analysis. So this is just a stress contour that I've just presented, for which is the result of a nonlinear analysis. So this again is another example of the result of a nonlinear analysis of a lipped channel section. This is a stress contour. Now these are all contour plots where you can see visually you can see what is happening, but that is not just sufficient, right? You need to have the values, right? Most commonly what you extract out of this is the load displacement plots, right? So this is where the visualization module comes into picture, where you can, one thing, you can graphically display the FEA model, and then you can extract out the results. So you have these XY data manager where you can just you know, choose what you want. So here I'm looking for my reaction forces. I'm looking for a P delta curve, that is load versus deformation plots. I'm just giving you an example. So suppose I'm going for that. I can just choose the parameter I want to extract, and I can just choose where I want to extract it, and then I can just plot it. So then you can just, you know, extract out these values and take, maybe if you are interested in the ultimate load, you can just extract out this result from the model, right? So basically you have done your model, you have analyzed it, you have got the result. Very good, right? You have the result from your analysis, right? So now, how do you know if your finite element modeling is correct or not? You have the results, as I showed here. You will, if you don't have any errors and your analysis has run, you will get some result. So how do you exactly know whether your result is correct or not, right? So the very important step while you have to follow is the validation of your finite element model. So this is the validation of my finite element modeling that I had done. That is the simply supported plates on three sides subjected to uniform compression, which I've been discussing throughout the lecture. It is experimentally being performed, being done by Bambach and Rasmussen in 2004. So what we did is, and they have a paper in this based on these experimental results. What we did is, we did our finite element modeling of those plates, and we were trying to predict the results they have got experimentally, right? So this is the P delta, I mean the stress versus axial displacement plot from the test, and the darkened points are those which I have obtained using Abacus. As you can see, they very well match with the experimental results, and this is a way of proving or showing that your finite element model is correct. So this is the tabular column of all the experiments they have performed, and here you can see the experimental result and my FEA results. So I've just highlighted one such example just to show you the comparison of the results. That is, from the test they have got a value of 147.5, whereas I've got a value of 149.2 MPa as my compressive stress. So it matches very well with my experimental predictions. So using this validated model, I can do my parametric study, or, you know, whatever I'm interested in doing. So first, the very important step while you're doing your analysis, using, when you're doing a simulation, is to make sure that you validate your finite element model. So as I told you, the imperfection factor, which you were using this 0.18 factor that I was talking about. So in this, they have reported experimentally measured values of the average imperfections. So I have made use of these factors to model these plates. So how well you model the actual experiment, that well your results will be the material, the geometry, boundary conditions, all that you have to pay very good attention to all those small details. Only then you will be able to simulate those models accurately. So this actually, we have a paper in Journal of Structural Engineering where we have presented the modeling details and the validation which I just presented now of the plate simply supported on three sides. So if you have any confusion with the modeling details that I have just discussed, you can just go through this paper that is available online, right? So this was a very simple example where I had modeled a two-dimensional plate which was subjected to axial compression. So this was actually a very simple, the analysis also did not take much time. But there are more complex structures that we can model in Abacus. So I'm just presenting the final results of a few of the analysis that we have done. So another example of a cross-section that was again tested by Young in the year 2005. So these are all published literatures available in standard journals, right? So as I told you, the first step of any work you're simulating is to validate your model. So this is the validation of my lipped angle sections that was tested by Young. So this is basically a cross section like this. So this fold, this is called the edge stiffener or lip. And I think most of you will be familiar with the angle section. This is called a lipped angle section, which is again subjected to uniform compression. So the difference from the previous plate problem is that there we just had a single part where we just had a rectangular plate. So here, experimentally, what they are doing is they have end plates. So this is just the FEA model, right? They have end plates at both the ends, and then they are applying the compression. So you have to model the end plates separately. One way is to directly model the end plates and then assemble it according to your problem. Or another thing you can do is there are options to apply constraints to your model, right? So that is what, as I told, as your model gets more complicated, your modeling process will also get complicated. But I didn't want to complicate my talk, so I went with a very simple example. So here we have to model these end plates. I've used constraint, or you can also use beam elements. That is another way of modeling this. And we'll apply the load on the boundary conditions at the CG of the cross section. This is again the results of just one set of tests. I'm just presenting just a few results just for the sake of the talk. So here, as you can see, these results also compare very well with the test results. And another few cross sections that we have modeled is the plane angled and the plane channel sections. And these are the references, or these are the people who have experimentally done these specimens. And we have just modeled it, trying to validate our model. So in general, deviation of 0.1, that is 10% difference, plus or minus 10% difference in your predictions is acceptable. Right. So that is on an average, that is the acceptable range. So one way to look at how good your model is to look at the mean and the standard deviation of your test to the predicted ratios. So with this, we have validated our finite element model. And with this, you can continue your analysis. So these are just a few of the references that I have referred to for this work. And with this, I'm just concluding my talk. So all here, I have just shared my experience with you in Abacus. There is still a lot of possibilities in Abacus that I have not personally explored. This is just a small portion of it, where I'm talking about the modeling of state structures. And I hope I've done justice to you by with this talk. So I'm just trying to, I just wanted you to get an overall idea about each of these steps, the basics. You know, it's always the basics that are important, right? So I wanted to convey all the basic steps that are involved in the modeling process so that you know how to approach a problem and, you know, what are the things that you should keep in mind while modeling your problems. So with this, I conclude my talk on the modeling of steel structures using the finite element software Abacus. So thank you for listening. So if you have any questions.
So, If you have any questions, you can ask now. So from the participant side, is there any doubts? Okay. So in that case, I take this opportunity to thank Ms. Ashwati for sharing her valuable knowledge with us on behalf of our department. I'm just expressing our gratitude to you. So thank you for sharing this knowledge with us. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, Ashwati. I am Manchester father.
Oh, okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Oh, okay. How is your work going on?
Yes, sir, it's going on well.
Well.
Ah, yes, sir.
Very good. All the best. What about the subject topic?
Sir, I'm working on buckling interactions in cold form steel structures.
Buckling interaction on?
Cold form steel structures.
Oh, cold form steel structures. Very good.
Yes.
Steel structures, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. All the very best.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay, I will tell him you are taking a class. Very good. Nice class.
Okay, thank you, sir. Okay.
Your sound, etc., sir, very good.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, bye.
Oh, okay. So thank you, Muthoot Engineering College, for giving me the opportunity to share part of my work with you all. Thank you.
So our next session starts at 2 p.m. So please try to log in at the earliest.